The World's Great Novels. The fame of Theodore Dreiser largely rests on such monumental novels as Sister Carrie and An American Tragedy. Few people know of Dreiser's short stories, which, in their way, are as powerful as his longer works. We depart, therefore, from our usual custom to present not a novel, but a story that is a study in mood, an introspective account of a man and his emotional self-immolation. We present a radio adaptation of Theodore Dreiser's Free, another in our series of stories that live. This is the story of Rufus Haymaker, a New York architect.
I was sitting there, looking out at the dawn, at the timid light that began to fall among the leaves of the long line of poplars across from our apartment, across from the tall, impersonal windows of our living room. The windows looked down upon an edge of Central Park and caught a corner of the shallow pond where children sailed little boats in the warm weather and where they skated during the wintertime. The view was familiar to me, even at this unusual time of the day or of the night, for I had stood here alone for many hours during these past weeks, watching for the morning to come, waiting for death to come. It was that peculiar time in New York City when all the sight and the sound of living has been, for a few moments, suspended, when it has been spread-eagled into the tense and reluctant 10 minutes of the absolute quiet of 4:30 a.m., I could see Dr. Storm's car parked on the uptown side of the awning, the front wheels turned against the curb. Dr. Storm's careful car and careful parking, his expensive, elegant, unobtrusive car. Not unlike the doctor himself, come to think of it. An expensive, elegant, unobtrusive doctor. Quiet, proficient, and professional. I was wondering whether Dr. Storm had ever in his whole life taken a charity case when the man himself walked into the gloom of the living room. I didn't hear him and I couldn't see him, but I knew he was there and that my wife was still alive and that he would reassure me at once that she was likely to recover, that she was dangerously ill, but that she would recover.
She is at that point, Mr. Haymaker, where things are in the balance. Later on today, if your wife is no better, I will call in my friend Dr. Granger, whom you know, for consultation. It's been a very trying case, Mr. Haymaker. A very stubborn case, I might say.
You think a day or two should tell?
3 or 4 at the most. Oh, we're not nearly at the end of our tether. I don't wish to alarm you unnecessarily. However, we never can tell. As an old friend of yours and Mrs. Haymaker's, and knowing how much you mean to each other, I feel it my duty to prepare you this way.
An old friend, knowing how much we mean to each other. Dr. Storm looked at me as though he were very sorry for me, as if I were an old man accustomed to my wife's ways and likely to be made very unhappy by her untimely end. What a farce. What a dull mixture of illusion and error. How could he know? How could anyone know what we had really meant to each other? The library door closed quietly, and I was left here in this same room as before with a dying wife, the stale fragrance of a hypocritical doctor, and my own conscience. The simple fact was that, contrary to Dr. Storm's most educated sympathy, I really did not want my wife to live. The simple fact was, I wanted her to die. I wanted her to die. Here I was, past 60, weary of all this, of living, really, and married 31 years to the same woman, and never in all that time, for even so much as a single day, had I ever been happy in my marriage. Never had I done anything but long to be free. Why did I allow this? Why did I let all of it happen? Why did I have to make so great a mistake so long ago? When I met Ernestine, I was too young to know exactly what I wanted to do or what I was going to feel in the years to come. I was stuck on her, as they said. And worse, there seemed to be an obligation to do something about this. Something not frivolous. There was no one to stop me, no one to tell me that I, a man with an artist's and architect's mind, was marrying a narrow, ultra-conventional small-town girl who adored only convention, money, success, and that we could never be happy together for a moment. Architecture? Art? What could they really mean to her? How could I ever make her understand that wisdom and art and true distinction might well take their rise only out of poverty and shabbiness and struggle? Take young Zingara now. We were young architects together in the offices of Pine and Starboard, and I was drawn to him, definitely. But because he smoked all the time and was shabby as to his clothes and had no money...
I wish you wouldn't bring him here anymore, dear.
Zingara? Why not?
Because he's low and vulgar and disreputable looking. I don't know what you see in the man.
But, Ernestine, just because he's poor, he's an artist. You can't judge him by ordinary standards. And he has a great mind. It gives me something. I don't know how I can explain it exactly.
I don't know either. To me, he's common. Why, just the other day, I saw him in a restaurant with a most drabby-looking woman. And he even dared to speak to me in her presence. Well, that's the end. I wish you wouldn't bring him here anymore, dear.
Yes, that was the end of Zingara. It was so many years ago. He's become a great architect now, a man I would give my soul to know. But my wife robbed me even of that. If the many buildings I have designed have been truly beautiful, it is because I have lavished all my love on them, being shut out from love and beauty elsewhere. Ernestine has robbed me of all other happiness. No. No, I'm wrong there. She gave me Elwell, our firstborn child. Elwell, that queer little lump of a face that I truly loved. And then that dreadful fever and Elwell's death. That chunky, happy-spirited boy who died the day after his second birthday fled like a shadow, and my life gone with him. Well, perhaps he was lucky. At least he escaped. Escaped what Ernestine has done to Wesley and Ethelberta, our other two children. Children? They're both in their late 20s now, and she's made them over into her own image. Narrow, conventional, shallow, empty. She was so sure she knew what her children wanted. So sure she was placing them exactly where they should be, among the best people in the social scale. And yet, without having the brains to know it, she has destroyed any possibility of happiness for Wesley and Berta. Both married, both lost. Both unbearably wretched. That's the truth of it. My children are as wretched as I am. Well, I'll call the night nurse to make me some coffee. I might as well get a little something out of this. And then I'm going down to the office for a few hours. I'll see Ernestine this evening. I'll have Mrs. Eldridge phone the children, have them up for supper tonight, and have the day nurse call to confirm it before Wesley has a chance to buy tickets for the polo grounds. Well, it's all very dull. How are you tonight, dear?
I've missed you. Have you been to the office?
I've been there all day. Dr. Storm said you were making wonderful progress. I called twice this afternoon. You look marvelous, dear.
Do I, my dear one?
Of course.
I'm so glad you came home early. What did Dr. Storm say about me?
He's absolutely positive that you're going to be well. And very soon, too.
Is he? I still feel very weak.
But Storm knows that you have a great deal of inherent vitality. He's going to pull you through.
And the children are coming for dinner. Good, good.
Or supper, dear. I didn't order anything very special about it, and it's been very hot. Worse on you, of course, but you can see.
Just like you, my dear. Always thinking of the others. Wesley's bringing his wife and Ethelbert, her husband, I suppose.
Well, not this time. Frankly, the in-laws, as it were, seem to be busy tonight, both of them.
Well, they both know that I've been terribly ill.
My dear, that's the very reason why Irma isn't coming with Wesley. I'm sure she feels that until you're entirely well, nothing should interfere with your getting back on your feet.
You know, Rufus.
Yes, dear?
When they first married, Wesley and Irma, I thought he was making a very good marriage. But now...
Yes?
I wonder sometimes if she's the right woman for him, if she isn't holding Wesley back.
Why, I don't know, dear.
Sometimes I think she cares so little for him, really. Sometimes I find myself thinking an evil thought. I find myself almost wishing he would leave her.
What a grim jest. She made that marriage. She alone is responsible for it. And now, against all her prejudices, she's almost willing for Wesley to leave his wife. But if I suggested anything like that in connection with us... To Ernestine, our marriage was a sacrament, sacrosanct, never to be dissolved. What a crime it would be in her eyes if I spoke. And so I've never dared to speak. Well, it's been my fault, really, more than hers. My fault because I've been so weakly conventional in my own way, so afraid of the scandal that might wreck my career, so resourceful in hiding my own emotions that I've been a model husband to Ernestine. Ernestine, who had never done anything in the 3 decades of our life together but bore me and plague me and force me into the company of people she thought could advantage us or elevate our chances for the social recognition which was at the core of her being. Well... In its strangely monotonous and abortive way, it has destroyed me. Destroyed my capacity to feel anything for her, anything at all. And destroyed our children, and even their capacity to feel anything much for either of us. I left my wife and went downstairs to wait for my son and my daughter. They were always late. They never wanted to come, and now, sensing the imminence of something dreadful, less than ever did they want to share the responsibility of a family appearance or accept the embarrassment of impending grief.
Good evening, Father.
Good evening, Wesley and Berta.
Strange time to be coming for supper. What are we having? What's the latest bulletin on the meter? And why don't you get them to us a little sooner?
I'm sorry, Ethelberta. I told you all I knew. I thought...
Oh, please, Berta. Father wanted us to come. Isn't that enough?
Enough? Not at all, Wesley. You didn't have to come. It just seemed to me that when your mother is very ill...
Of course, Father. I'm sure Berta didn't mind leaving her cocktail party.
Father, please don't misunderstand. Of course I'm concerned about Mother. She is my mother, isn't she? Why do you think I wouldn't want
to
be...
But Wesley said he had to get you out of the cocktail party.
Well, it was just that I knew where she was.
It was just that he knew where I was going to be. What's the matter with that? Should I be mourning for Mother when she's not even dead?
Berta, please.
Certainly I went to a party. After all, what else is there to do with your time?
What else? What else to do with her time but follow the empty rounds of an empty social life? Well, Ernestine has done this too. Shaped them both to conform to her own shallow mold, a mold made of money, nothing but money. Where money was position, money was success. Money and what it bought was all that mattered. And how well they fitted into that mold now. How fully they accepted Ernestine's own viewpoint of it. That Ernestine had been a colossal failure as a mother to them and as a wife to me never occurred to the two surviving children who bore my name, accepted my favors, and regarded me as an old and useless man. As perhaps I was. How do you think she is this evening, Miss Filson?
No worse, I think. Possibly a little better.
Did you take her pulse?
Yes, sir. It's very nearly normal.
Did the children... Was she glad to see that...
Your son and your daughter?
Yes. I always think of them as children. I suppose that's proof of how old I am.
Why, Mr. Haymaker, you're not an old man. Neither is Mrs. Haymaker old. I think you're very distinguished looking, both of you.
Why, thank you, Miss Filson. No one ever said anything like that to me before, about my wife and me, I mean.
But I'm sure they must have.
Well, thank you anyhow.
Seeing Mrs., I don't think I know your daughter's married name.
Kelso. Mrs. John Kelso.
Well, seeing Mrs. Kelso seemed to give Mrs. Haymaker quite a lift. Picked up her spirits.
Good, good.
I expect that'll be Dr. Storm. He's planning to give her a transfusion tonight.
Oh, is he? Miss Filson.
Yes, sir?
Whatever is needful. She mustn't die if you can help it.
We'll do our best. You may be sure.
Yes, yes. You must do your best.
The heart is just fine, Mr. Haymaker. I know you'll be glad to hear that. But the blood count...
Yes?
Yesterday's transfusion lighted up her face and seemed to revive her generally. But systemically, it didn't last. I've talked the thing over with Dr. Granger.
Yes? What does he think?
Oh, he's sure she's going to pull through, just as sure as I am.
Can't these men see that I have no wish for her to go on living?
And, of course, the idea of using horse's blood instead of the blood of a healthy human, it's thicker than human blood.
Why can't I be free of all this? Why do I have to castigate myself for wishing to be free? She's going to get well, and I'll go on forever being a prisoner of my own marriage.
And being thicker than human blood, and what we call the same plasmic pattern, it isn't so easily bled out of the heart when injected as a serum.
You're wonderfully kind and resourceful, Dr. Storm. You must save her life. Somehow, you must save her.
Oh, we have every reason to think that she'll rally. My dear man, I don't wish to give you any reckless, unprofessional hope. But knowing your great devotion to Mrs. Haymaker, I promise you, if we pull her through this present, this immediate crisis, it is entirely possible she will live for another 25 years.
Dr. Storm walked carefully up the stairs to bring life back to Ernestine.
You're wonderfully kind and resourceful, Dr. Storm. You must save her life. Somehow you must save her.
My dear man, it is entirely possible she will live for another 25 years.
Oh, no. Oh, please. Oh, no one knows how lonely I've been. How bored. Can the weight of any man's sorrow be as great as the knowing how thankless my children are, how lost and useless they are? Why does a man so desperately desire such wonders from woman? and get nothing from her mind but monotony, and nothing from her body but a physical projection of the same thing. A son without a brain in his head, and a daughter without a soul. Oh, let me lie down and die instead of this poor wife of mine. This happy, empty, and somewhat terrified woman. She's been happy. And too stupid, too smug to see the wreckage of the very things that she, on a witness stand, would claim to love. Would claim to have given her life for. Let me lie down for just a moment. A moment.
You've been lonely, haven't you? You've been very alone, haven't you?
Yes. Yes, alone. Always alone. How did you know? Who are you?
I've been watching you, wondering about you. All your life, you've missed something, haven't you?
Yes. Yes, I have. I've missed...
You've missed love.
Yes. Yes, I've missed love.
I've come to bring it to you. To make up for the days, the empty hours, the fallen years. I've come to pick them up again. I'm all the things that Ernestine has denied. I am the love you lost. I am the woman of your desire. I'm here. Here.
What is your name? Let me hold you. Let me touch you.
Mr. Haymaker. Mr. Haymaker, come at once, please. Dr. Storm says to come at once.
We've done everything we could. She seemed to respond remarkably at first to the transfusion.
Did she go peacefully?
With great serenity. At the very end, she seemed very willing to go. She didn't fight it.
Oh, Ernestine. Oh, Ernie. Dear, are you really gone?
I think it's better we go downstairs. Miss Filson?
I'll take care of everything, Dr. Storm.
Thank you.
Thank you for all that you've done, Dr. Storm. Thank you.
I only wish I could have kept life in her. But you've had a blessed life, Mr. Haymaker. A blessed life.
Yes, a blessed life.
30 years of marriage, your son told me. Never a cross word, never a misunderstanding. A life enriched by loyal children. A son like yourself. And a daughter, an almost magical image of her mother. Almost the same person.
Yes, almost the same person.
Oh, how can I be saying these evil sentences? Why don't I tell Dr. Storm that I feel nothing but release, that I'm free, I'm free.
Mr. Haymaker, you know how deeply I regret...
I know you did all that you could, Doctor. I am experienced enough, Dr. Storm, to realize that this is also very difficult for you, sir.
You're a man of rare and profound understanding. Good night, sir.
Good night, Dr. Storm. Yes. Yes, it's true. It's true. I am free. I've still got some fine years in me. I'm not even stooped. I walk like a young man. I'm free.
Free to do what?
Free to live. To be.
Free to go back to the dream you had with a pretty woman. Free to go back to the days of your youth. Are you free to change your mind, Mr. Haymaker?
I don't care. I'm free. That's the main thing.
Yes. But free to do what? What is there that you want to do without Ernestine? That you can do?
I can be myself.
Can you?
Of course. It's all any man ever wants to be. Just to be himself.
Very few men ever find their way to it. Isn't it true that you're just an old man? A disappointed old man without a single... project on his mind, without a single plan, without even a single desire.
But, Miss Filson, in this very room, she said I was distinguished, that I looked distinguished.
Yes, I heard her. But it means more to you than it should. A good deal more than it means to her.
But she did mean it.
True. But what did she mean? Surely you can't think that you fascinate her, that you appeal to her. You've been dreaming, Mr. Haymaker. And it is pitiful, the years you've waited to be free. Why didn't you do something about it when you had power over these things? Why didn't you leave her?
I don't need to now. She's dead. She's dead. She's dead as a doornail.
Yes, she is. And you're free. Free to go and to do as you wish. But you have no plan. You have nothing to give your freedom to. Nothing. You're no better off than before. Entirely free, if you insist. But free only to die.
Free by Theodore Dreiser is one of the world's great stories brought to you each week by the NBC University of the Air. The radio adaptation of Free was made by Max Wiley, and the entire production was under the direction of Homer Heck. Maurice Copeland was featured as Rufus Haymaker. Others were Larry Alexander, Geraldine Kay, Rosemary Kelly, Sherman Marks, Alma Platz, and Lee Young. The music was composed by Emil Soderstrom, and the orchestra was under the direction of Bernard Berquist. The NBC University of the Air is proud to announce that this summer's series of contemporary novels is being used by the University of Louisville as part of their home study course, and it is our plan to make such courses available eventually in other areas. And now, speaking on the subject of radio and adult education, we present Dr. Cyril Houle, Dean of the University College at the University of Chicago.
Good evening. The National Broadcasting Company, in presenting this series of great American novels, is making possible a kind of adult education which clarifies and vitalizes the ideas which should animate mankind. In cooperation with the University of the Air, the University of Louisville is offering a correspondence course on contemporary American literature, of which tonight's broadcast forms a part. Adult education, among other things, should provide a vision of greatness. Soon, education in America will be adult education. For soon there will be 3,000 adults for every 1,000 children in this country. And there's more and more leisure time in America. Within 25 years, at least 75 million adults are going to be participating in programs of adult education. This fact presents at once an enormous opportunity and a great responsibility to American educational institutions, among which radio is becoming increasingly important. The University of Chicago has long been a leader in adult education. For 18 years, the University of Chicago Roundtable, a part of NBC's University of the Air, has been engaged in the task of candid and intrepid thinking about fundamental issues. Our experience and that of others has demonstrated very clearly that radio by itself is a powerful instrument for the spread of knowledge and opinion and the creation of attitudes. Now an attempt is being made to see how such learning can be aided and reinforced by the use of other means which help the student to clarify and communicate his thoughts. Through great literature and through great discussion, radio can clarify important issues of public life and stimulate further study and thought.
Thank you, Dr. Houle. Next week, World's Great Novels will present a radio adaptation of The Triumph of the Egg by Sherwood Anderson. Why not visit your local public library and borrow a copy for your own reading? It's to be had for the asking. This is Charles Chan speaking. This program came to you from Chicago, and is a presentation of the National Broadcasting Company and its affiliated independent stations. This is NBC, the National Broadcasting Company.